for the lecture has not been fulfilled because the participants or the learners did not really understand, as they did not have the entry behavior or they did not have the competencies to understand the concepts or the lecture delivered. This can happen because of various reasons. One is that those who are the participants do not have the prerequisite information or knowledge, and the course or the lecture is being delivered on a different level, and as such the learners are not able to comprehend. The second is that there might be problem in the medium of instruction. So what happens at times is that learners do not have the linguistic capability or capacity to understand the lectures delivered by the teachers. This can also happen in distance mode, where the material is distributed or imparted in a language in which the learners do not have the competency. Now, in such a situation, what happens is that learners are not able to comprehend the material. It has been mentioned in the study material, and I think you must have read it, that in such a situation, it is important to understand the learners. So, if we do an exercise, and it is important to do this exercise as teachers or trainers, that we understand our learners. This can depend upon their background, social background. This can also become depend upon their academic background, that they are not able to comprehend the material that is delivered either through lecture or through study material. So we need to understand our learners. We also need to understand their capabilities in receiving information or knowledge through various means, lectures, or when other media are used, they are not able to comprehend or understand the symbol system of these media and methods. So it is important to understand the learners first, because it is not, as we do not lecture or teach in a vacuum. The clientele must be prepared to understand what is being delivered. So this is one part of it, and which is a very important aspect of delivering any course to a group, that we understand that learners and their backgrounds. In designing courses, we normally include topics, and this should depend upon the duration that is given. How much time is available for delivering or imparting a course, and also the resources available. Because if we do not have the adequate resources, perhaps we would not be able to impart all that is said on the given in a particular course. Say for example, a course in sciences. If we do not have the labs available, perhaps we would not be able to demonstrate and show to the learners and develop those capabilities, or let them do the practicals if we do not have the laboratories available. Similarly, in language courses, perhaps if they do not have the adequate linguistic capability, they would not be able to comprehend. So it is important to understand that courses are not delivered in a vacuum. They are delivered to a group of people or learners who have certain understanding and who have undergone some sort of learning activity. So we must try to understand them and then accordingly sequence depending upon the time available. Now, sequencing is another important aspect which we must understand, that sequencing the material is very important. As one person normally doesn't teach all the topics of a course, so what happens that when two or three teachers are teaching, or resource persons are engaging the group, they might be overlapping, or one of them might be doing something which has to be taught after the first one has done it. So it is important that we sequence our topics as well. As it was mentioned, that when we prescribe books, perhaps we do not do justice to it, and it should be according to topics, and it should be sequenced accordingly, so that a topic which has to be taught after a certain information or knowledge that has been given to the learner, that topic comes. So time is important and sequencing is important. There are possibilities of alternative sequencing as well. Perhaps there might not be one sequencing which is true and which can be done. Perhaps we can have separate and different types of sequencing, which will also depend upon the resources available. So it is important to analyze the resources available, and accordingly we should sequence our courses. Now I will invite Dr. Sanjay Mishra first to talk about various media and methods that can be used, and after that we'll discuss about what are the other case studies in it. But let me invite all of you from various places to ask your questions as and when you have a question, so that we can keep answering your questions, and let us make it an interactive session rather than a lecture method or monologue. So Dr. Mishra.
Thank you, Professor Sharma, and good afternoon to all the viewers at all the reception centers. It's my privilege to be here to share some of the ideas on selection of methods and media in course design. As Professor Sharma has already emphasized the need of objective specification, I would like to straight go into selection of methods and media. However, before doing that, I would just like to have a recap of the overview of course design. If you look at the overview of course design, what are the specific tasks that we do when we are designing a course? The most important thing is the course goals and aims. For what purpose for this that you are doing this course? That's what Professor Sharma emphasized about the whether it is a skill-based course or it's a training-related course or any all those kind of things. Then the next important thing is looking into the national, regional, and local needs. When you are designing a course, you are actually designing a course based on certain needs at certain level. At a national level, there may be teachers required, and therefore you have to have more courses offered at different places. But at a local level, you might think that there is a need for a fishery course because there is a lot of abundant resources for fishery and pisciculture. So there are different local, regional, and national needs. Looking into that, a course is designed. The most important thing that is emphasized here is the course objective specification. Every course will have its own objective, leading to instructional objectives in lessons that are covered in the course. Those lessons are actually nothing but course listing, and Professor Sharma has rightly identified about that, the importance of sequencing of the course listing and use of time and resources to facilitate these courses over a period of 1 year or 6 months or so. The next important aspect is selection of methods and media. Then, of course, the preparation of instructional materials. As teacher, you would like to also prepare some of the instructional material, whether it is handouts or a PowerPoint presentation or audio, video, or whatever, depending on your resources. And of course, the most important is implementation of the plan. Whatever you do so far is your planning document, and you need to implement those plan in the classroom. And the last aspect is evaluation. It's also evaluation of the student performances and also the program evaluation. So the last two activities are going to be taken off in the next session. But in this particular session, I'm actually emphasizing on selection of methods and media. So what exactly are the factors that affect selection of methods and media? If you look at, there are four specific factors, and these factors actually affect selection of methods and media. These factors are the students themselves, the objectives of the course, the environment at which the course is being delivered, and the resources available. Students mean here the analysis of the student's entry behavior. What qualities the students bring into the classroom? One specific thing Professor Sharma also highlighted about is the competency level of the students, the language competency level of the students. So you, in order to decide on methods, media, you need to have an understanding of the entry behavior of the students so that you can decide about the applicability of different methods and media in appropriately. Then the objectives. What is the objective of the course overall? If it is more skill-based, then you might be going into more practical-oriented scene. And if practical is to be done, how that practical things will be carried out, whether in a laboratory situation, or you can take actually the students into the field and actually do those activities. So the objective has to be analyzed in detail. The third aspect is the environment. Where are you going to execute the course? Naturally, in our context, it is a classroom. But in the classroom also, how big is your classroom? How many students are going to be there? Is it a small tutorial kind of classroom with 16, 15 students, or it's a big hall with having 120 students? So it needs on the environment. In the environment comes the resources. In that, do you have multimedia projectors? Do you have overhead projectors? Do you have blackboard? Do you have whiteboard? What kind of resources are available at your disposal? Do you have audio video playing facilities? So you need to look at all these four aspects, then you can actually decide on selection of methods and media appropriately. So when you are looking at course design, the most important thing is that you must decide on your course objectives in detail first. Then, of course, course listing. Once you have done these things, and then look at these four aspects: students' entry behavior, the course objectives, the environment of delivery of the course, and the resources that are available, the finances that you have, the expertise that you have. You may think that I would like to use a multimedia, but you may not have the capabilities and resources to use multimedia in your classroom. So you need to analyze. The multimedia might be the best method, but you don't have those resources. So what resources available play a significant role in selection of methods and media in teaching learning scenario and designing of the course. This is what I'm going to emphasize. But in that scenario, I would like to emphasize that people will ask, what comes first? Identification of methods comes first, or media comes first, or instructional materials come first. I present it in a selection wheel. To me, methods, instructional material, and media, these are three important components of teaching learning transition that happens in the classroom scenario. So it could start from anywhere. You can say that I have decided on a method, then I will go into media, and then I will go into instructional material development. But somebody else say, I have an instructional media like a video, I would like to use that as a trigger in a classroom, and then go into methods and in fact media. So to me, it's a cycle, it's a wheel. So from anywhere you can start. The scenario could be methods, then go into media and instructional material. You can decide on a media, then go into instructional material and method, and you can have instructional material, methods, and media. It's a cycle of sort. So you can start anywhere. But the most important is that you have your objective specification and you have your course sessions, course listings that are decided as sessions or lecture sessions or whatever the nomenclature that you use. The very important aspect here is that how to decide. I will go into that in a little bit of time, but I will now give you two scenarios, two sets of scenarios, one on methods. So look at these four scenarios and start thinking about what kind of method that you will use in your own situation. You can pour in your answer by calling us back also. The first four set on methods, I'm going to read it aloud. The first scenario is, in a labs, students to find out whether there is relationship among voltage, resistance, and current. What kind of methods you are going to use? I'm not going to talk about methods at this stage. I'm going to talk about various types of methods later on. The second one is, you want to teach dissection of a frog in a classroom. The third one, you want students individually explore a topic such as India's first war of independence and get together to share their learning. What kind of method it would be in the classroom? The fourth one, student practice conflict resolution through role playing. So these are four scenarios. Think about these scenarios, what kind of methods that you would like to use. There is no single answer to it, but there could be a best fit, the best possible method for that purpose. Let me show the next four set of scenarios for media selection. So first, you want to show production of iron or steel. So what kind of media that you would like to use? The next one, you want to use learning the topic is learning jingles for an advertising class. You are going to teach advertising, and there you are going to use how to develop good jingles for audio or radio for that matter. The third one, you want to teach discovering the various facets of Indian history. How you are going to, what kind of media that you would like to use. And the fourth one, the topic of the fourth scenario is the human heart. What is that media that you would like to use if the topic of your teaching is the human heart. So these are four media scenarios and four the method scenarios that I would like to pose at this stage. I am going to give the best fit as according to me as a teacher at the end. But let's start thinking about the methods and media. I am just trying to throw some ideas about thinking about methods and media, how you would like to make use of in the classroom. So once you start thinking about these methods and media, you keep on pouring your views, start discussing in this virtual class that you have here from various centers for EC Extended Contact Program. Think about yourself as an individual, or you can discuss with your colleague there on and give us your feedback right here so that we can proceed further. I think Professor Sarma, you will take some time before we receive some calls.
Yes, thank you, Sanjay, and I think Dr. Mishra has given very good exercises to you, and start working on it, as he has said. Start pouring in your questions so that we can discuss all that we are saying, and it's not just a monologue. As it will appear to you that we are talking overall about how to impart a course effectively so that the learning is enhanced. Now, let me take a few examples. Initially, we discussed about what is a course and how is it designed, what is the relationship between each lecture and a course, and courses and the program. Let me give an example from your study material. A particular teacher was teaching physics, and after teaching the whole course, the teacher started evaluating the students, and it was found that most of them had not understood it. Now, it was a surprise to the teacher because he found that the students had certain background qualification to enter into the classroom, and they were well qualified. Now, what happened that they did not understand or they could not perform? There was a mismatch between the delivery and the reception, that learners were not able to learn as much as it was expected, and an exercise was undertaken to find out. It was found that most of the learners had very poor competence in English, and the lectures were delivered in English, as it has been given in your textbook. I believe if you have read, you would know that the students were then given exercises in English language. Various aspects of English language, they did not understand the grammar, they also could not understand the terms. So it was decided to develop some material to develop competency in the jargon of that discipline and also general ability to understand English language. Now, this is just one case study that has been given, and you can have other exercises. As Dr. Mishra has said, that if you are using various media, I believe it's important to undertake that exercise of understanding which media would the students be able to understand better. Let me just mention that, I mean, we have years of training in reading textbooks and understanding or deciphering information from textbooks, but how much of training do we have in understanding material or content that is imparted through television or radio? Do we have the ears for understanding the radio lessons? Do we have the eyes and competencies to understand lessons delivered through video lessons? So it is important to understand whether our students would be able to understand all that is imparted through audio lessons or video lessons. We do not just decide on one medium to use it in our classrooms. As Dr. Mishra has given a very good term, and it should be used as a trigger. if you understand your learners, you would know which media to be used and when. It's not indiscriminate. You cannot just decide on any medium that is available to you. Textbooks, perhaps it's a foregone conclusion and we all use it, but then which other medium? And as he said, it's a very good trigger to engross your learners. So it has to be a proper mix of the content that we have to impart and to fulfill the objectives of the program and the courses, and then use various media and methods. Perhaps it has been mentioned that we should first try to understand the problem. What is that focus of the program or the course which the designers have identified as the main focus of the course, or what is the problem which has been identified, so that every time we are in a teaching learning activity, we should focus on that and slowly try to achieve those objectives. And in the process, we have to decide, as Dr. Mishra has given you some exercises, and I'm sure you must be doing all those exercises and you'll soon be asking us some questions. If we are teaching dissection, which methods or media to be used and why? So in teaching biology, for that matter, or physics, or then language, which medium would be most effective, that we have to understand. And ultimately, what do we want to achieve? So that is the problem of the, or the objective of the program or the course. Then we also have to Koraput. Koraput, yes. Yes, Koraput.
Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, Professor.
Your comments, Sharma, questions, please.
This is KC Dalai from Koraput Rhythm Center.
Yes, Dalai.
Hello.
Yes, Dalai. Go ahead.
We have at the moment five participants. Yes, thank you. I'm going in. There are five participants with us today, and two more expected to reach in the afternoon.
Yeah.
Our friends over here have a question to put to you on course design. That is, they say that in IGNO system, where the hierarchical linkage scheme of the program, as from program to course, from course to block, from block to unit, from unit to mesosection, section, and from mesosection section to subsection. Mm-hmm. Whereas in the traditional system that they are in, they are the system from program to course, then directly from course to unit, or they call it chapter. Mm-hmm. So from chapter, mesosection and subsection, would they design the course as per IGNO norm, from program to course, then block, then unit, or as per the traditional system of from program to course, then directly from course to unit, deviating the pattern of block, avoiding block? Which one should they go for? That is the question they wanted to ask. Thank you.
Thank you, Dalai, for the question, and I believe you are the best person to answer this question. You are a person from education, you could have answered, but for the benefit of all those who are at different centers, I believe distance education course designing and program designing is more scientific, to my understanding. We may differ on this, and other participants are welcome to differ on this. But the smaller the unit, the better the objective, perhaps, and we can perhaps fulfill that objective in a much better manner. So the purpose behind dividing the units into sections and then subsections, according to the objectives that the unit writer or the program course coordinator has done, I think it is more scientific. What will happen if you have a book and there are chapters and they are not divided into sections, but books are prescribed? And remember, if you have read the material that has been highlighted, that normally in traditional system, we prescribe books, and then you have certain lessons, which perhaps, to my understanding, is not very scientific. So perhaps distance mode course designing, and as you said already, program, course, block, unit, section, subsection, is more scientific and easier for the learners to understand. Perhaps we have a question from Jaipur. Yeah, Jaipur.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Mamta Bhatia from RC Jaipur. We have five participants here. And we also have our program director, Dr. Sarita Jain. Two of them are principals of degree colleges, and others are lecturers in different disciplines. Okay. Dr. Manoj Kumar Sharma, one of the participants, would like to ask a question.
Yes, please.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Welcome.
I want to a question or query
in relation to course design. How we make implement of plan in a college affiliated by university or UGC or higher governing body. I want to implement, but cannot implement the syllabus or course. Sir, I want to ask a method to prove my query.
Yeah, please. Have you completed? Right, Manoj, I think this has been objection or a question raised by academics over centuries, I believe now, that the course or the program is designed by those who are at the university level or at the headquarters of the university, but it has to be more egalitarian and democratic. Perhaps, I think distance mode is more democratic in that sense that we have large number of people involving in the whole process. And if you look at the national curriculum framework of the NCERT 2005, I believe you would be convinced that a more objective oriented planning has been done. The recent national curriculum framework does not prescribe topics. It says objectives and competencies that they wish to develop in learners. Perhaps at the higher education level, it has not been done. I am not very sure about it. Certain universities might have developed curriculum or syllabus based on objectives or competencies to be developed in learners. But if you look at the national curriculum framework of the NCERT 2005, you will find that they are not based on textbooks as such. They have clearly mentioned what are the competencies that they wish to develop in learners, and accordingly also the evaluation would be done, and it has been mentioned. I think Sanjay, if you like to add something.
Professor Sarma, that's nice, Professor Sarma, but I would like to add one. This is a very interesting dilemma in our college and university teachers that we always face with, that the curriculum is prescribed, designed by a group of people alien to me as a teacher, and I am asked to transact that in a classroom scenario. And I have little freedom to transact that in terms of methods and media and others. This is what we always feel. But let us look at a real syllabus given to by a university. And as an individual teacher, what we can do? That's what course design is all about. That's what this exercise that is being done here is all about. I emphasize that four important factors. That you have to look at the local resources available. I just can't go and ask the principal that I want something which is not available in the college. In order to transact my course, as a teacher, you just cannot go and ask something out of the moon. We have to transact our course according to the resources available. But the most important thing is that course objectives, that what Professor Sarma is emphasizing again and again, has to be met. At the end of the course, the students have to get into the objectives, that they have achieved the objectives at the end of the course. I'll continue
would
this
you
point.
Would like to hear Jaipur first?
Yeah, we'll hear Jaipur. I will continue this.
Hello?
Yes, please.
Hello? Sir, my Dr. Ankita Sharma bol rahi hu Jaipur se.
Ji.
Sir, meri query hai ki after the implementation of the course, is there any time period or a specific time prescribed for the revision of the course curriculum? Hello?
Yeah, please.
Hello?
Ji, aapka prashn sun liye.
Sir, implement karne ke baad mein koi specific time period hai usse fir se revise karne ke liye, ya fir usko as per need you can revise any time after 1 month or after one session?
I think Sanjay, before I invite
you,
Sanjay to speak, Sanjay has just mentioned that you are best placed as you know your learners and you are there, so you have to decide. So I believe whether you have the time or not depends upon the pace by which you have gone through the course. If you have decided beforehand that I will be doing that revision, perhaps you would have spared some time for that. Sanjay,
I would like to submit and tell all the learners here that let us not go into an erroneous thinking that course design is a one-time activity, and therefore it needs to be revision after 5 years or 2 years or 3 years. Course design is a continuous activity and it never stops. So it is an iterative process. It keeps on improving all the time. So there is no time that we revise. You are actually in a constant state of revision all the time. So please take it in that scenario. And that's what I am trying to emphasize as a teacher, what we can do. As a teacher, what we can do is to look at the objectives of the course. Sometimes the objectives are not given, only topics are given. As a teacher, we have to articulate the objectives of this course and the specific content based on our knowledge, based on our expertise on the field. And then according to that, according to the resources available, we need to decide on methods. What method I will transact? There is no single best method for any topic. One topic can be taught through different methods. Similarly, one topic can be used through different media. But there could be an optimum method or optimum media. You may not have the facilities for the optimum media or method. Therefore, you will use the best available to you. So this is the critical situation in a college or a university scenario when it is given to us. So our role is very important, and therefore this exercise of course design in PGDD is an extremely useful exercise that if you look at. And there I would like to emphasize those methods and media. You have not gone into questions, but
I think Sanjay, we have another question. Yes,
I think we got disconnected. Let me continue with the instructional methods. There are very type of instructional methods available to us. Most common one is lecture method. But how many times we have used other methods like cooperative learning, the discovery method, allowing students to work on problem solving problems, use of games, instructional games actually, helping students to be in groups, small groups discussions. Drill and practice, demonstration many time we do because we call it lecture demonstration. These are just not names, but I think you have a lot of examples and illustration in your study material on this. We'll take the question, please.
Yes. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes. We can hear you. Ask your question.
Good afternoon again. This is KC Dalai.
Yes, Dalai.
In fact, I just wanted to supplement
yes.
with what Professor Sharma and Dr. Misra have been talking about course design on the necessity of it.
Yes, please.
In fact, this is a very fantastic idea to include course design in the extended contact program where we are meeting face to face with the students. Course design simply doesn't mean that we are designing a course as such and leaving it onto it. It is a mechanism, it's a process which even includes teaching learning activity transacted in the classroom
mm-hmm.
that the teacher is devoted to. So it has all the requirements of the necessity of a teacher that he does in the classroom, even starting from methods, context, background, objectives, methods and media, assessment, and program evaluation.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever you find in the program evaluation that there are some shortcomings, you come back to the beginning again. From the background context, it goes on, it's a cyclic process, and it is very, very necessary for every teaching profession. And it should be kept at rest any confusion that course design a teacher is not necessitated to go for. But practically speaking, in classroom transaction, he does something of a course design or some portion of it. And it is therefore very, very necessary for all teaching fields in the country today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dalai. I believe, well supplemented. As Dr. Mishra had just mentioned, if you heard the last line, it's not a terminal behavior. It's not one-time activity. It's a continuous process which we keep doing, and perhaps we'll always need to refine every course. So we cannot say we have reached a stage where it's the ultimate. So as Dalai has just mentioned, and we respect his ideas, that it's a continuous process, and we have to keep doing it, I think.
I'd like to emphasize one very important thing here is that most of the time we face the dilemma about what media, what method to choose. Matching method and media becomes very important. And you can see on the screen that I have listed few of the instructional media. And all these things that you can use in a classroom, but not necessarily that you all have resources in your situation to use. But I think at times I need to use audio cassettes or video or handouts or real model or objects which can be used. Most of the time we use presentation, PowerPoint presentation or graphics, pictures and all those things, slides, transparencies, all these types of instructional media. I did not emphasize on all these things you have available in the media. But I would like to emphasize on this. Look at this slide carefully, the screen carefully. This is what a suggestion that how one can match methods and media. In the left hand side you have lectures, demonstration, cooperative learning, discovery method, problem solving, instructional games, drill and practices. And the right hand side you have audio, video, multimedia, models, transparencies or graphics, pictures and text. And you see what kind of when it is methods, what kind of media is applicable. For example, lecture. When you are in lecture situation, you can use an audio, you can also use a video, you can use transparencies, slides, you can use also text like a handout. But you want to use a demonstration method, video could be a very good one. Multimedia, use of actual models, transparencies, all this. And these are the blocks that I have given for you. Look at this carefully to note it down so that you can actually have methods and media matching. I asked you about the questions. These are the answers at that time. I have not received any things, but you can debate and discuss about these things. The first one answer is discovery. Second, demonstration. Third one is cooperative learning. Fourth one is simulation for the methods. For the media, the first answer is video. Second is audio. Third is multimedia. And fourth is model. I think we have had enough of this topic, and we are coming towards the end of the session. At this stage, let me wrap up the session by emphasizing on what we have talked about in this session particularly and had interaction with Jaipur and Koraput.
Very quickly, Calcutta, yes.
30 seconds.
Hello.
Yeah, very
good
quick.
Afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. You have mentioned that some national, regional, and local needs at the point. Mm-hmm. Give me some examples that any course in the course design of a professional course, what can be done in regional and local needs.
State
some examples and
clarify
a little.
I think
Dr. Mishra will wrap up the program, and during that he will also answer your question.
If you look at the whole process of course design, it starts basically with your course goals and aims. That's problems. What is that you want to actually transact? The content of the transaction. Then we look at the learner behavior, analysis of the learners and what their entry levels. That's what you do, the needs analysis. What are the kind of the students' needs and all those. At this point, the national, regional and local needs come into play. When I say national, regional and local needs, I'm not telling that these are sacrosanct. These are dependent on the course design. For example, you have a course, as I gave you example of a fishery. At a local level, an autonomous college decides and thinks that there is a need for a fishery course, a certificate course in fishery for people around, so that they will develop. At a national level, government will think that is a need, there is specific needs for some category of skill development staff. So those courses will be developed. For professional things, mostly it is a competence based and doesn't differ depending on the local, regional and local needs. So that would be my response. But the next important thing is depending on the needs, you need to articulate on the instructional objectives, decide on methods and media, prepare instructional materials, and of course the next two sessions will also deal with implementation and evaluation of these sessions. I think this is what is useful.
Yes, I think we have time enough to say only that much. Thank you all, and wait for the next session on assessment and evaluation and program evaluation. Keep your questions ready and make the program more interactive. Thank you very much, and for the moment, goodbye.
Thank you.